So open your Bibles to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 3 in the New Testament, past the Gospels, past Acts and Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians. Then you come to 1 and 2 Timothy, chapter 3, and we're going to go through verses 16 through 4, maybe 5, we'll see. But we're going to go through there. I know most of you. Some of you haven't got to meet. Some of you are new. After service, I'm always rehearsing or something, and some of you are out the door quick. So if I don't know you, my name's Brett. I am the worship leader, of course, but I'm also the youth pastor, and I've been able to teach our teens for some time now. Really enjoy it. A lot of hard work, but me and my wife are learning and really enjoying it. The best support you can give is to be involved in the church yourself and pour out your heart loving our teens so that they'll come. If you've got teens, bring them to church, whether they want to or not. I didn't have a choice in the matter. Bring them to church, send them to Sunday school, and I'll hoot and holler at them for a little bit in there. I promise you I'll share with them the Word of God. This morning, 2 Timothy chapter 3, and if you know anything about this letter, it's written to Timothy, who is a what? He's a pastor. So this message is a message to the preacher. So, most of you aren't preachers, right? So, what does this have to do with you? Well, there's a few preachers in our church, our pastor, Brother Nate, Brother Jeremy, Brother Monty, Brother Robert, a few different preachers in our church. There's more, and I encourage you, get involved in our Sunday school program, our small groups. It's a great time to fellowship, to get to know each other better. That way we're more in love with each other as a church, but also more time in the Word, and that is always good. And lots of good Sunday school teachers in our church from adults on down to little babies. So get involved in that. But what does this have to do with you if you're not a preacher? Well, this has everything to do with us. This tells us what to expect of preaching. What we're to hear when we are taught the Word of God, the importance of this. It teaches us what we ought to search for. If you're ever in a situation where you're not at this church, which I would love it if you could all be here till you die, that would be wonderful. But life takes us places, right? People move for jobs and work and family reasons. I pray that you will always be in a church that teaches the Bible following this example of Scripture here. And I've got 4 points this morning. My sermon title, The Perfect, Powerful, Purposeful Word. Try to say that 5 times fast. Good luck. But I've got 4 points this morning. My first point is this. God's Word is breathed. God's Word is breathed. Let's read. Go ahead and read through the entire passage. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do come to you again, and we ask you to speak to us this morning. Lord, we want to understand your word. Lord, we come to your word because we know that it is good to us. It is profitable to us, Lord, and we're going to learn that this morning. Lord, I pray that you would just open everyone's ears. Lord, open my heart, open my ears to understand what I'm teaching. Lord, I thank you that you've given us this wonderful gift of your word. Lord, so this is the reason we're gathered here, to open up your word and to grow from it, Lord. So we just ask that you would bless our time together, and we ask all of this in your name. Amen. Amen. God's word is breathed. If you read the scripture there, many versions say, it says all scripture is what? Many of them say given by inspiration of God, and it was translated that way to help you understand, because a lot of us don't understand what it means for God breathed. What does that mean? But God breathed is a better translation, I believe, because it speaks of the miracle that it is. It wasn't that the people that wrote these words were just inspired by the love that they had for God, and they thought, oh man, God loves me, that's so inspiring, let me write some words. That's not what happened. This word is a miracle of God, that he breathed his word into men, and they wrote as God's word had given them. 2 Peter chapter 1, we don't know everything about how it worked, but we do know this. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were motivated by the Holy Spirit. Like I said, we don't understand everything about it, but we do know this. It is God's word, not man. the penmen that wrote this, Moses, Paul, the many other different people that wrote in this word, were not the authors of it. It is not their message to us. This was God's message to us. It was God's message to the people in those times, and it is God's message to us. It is his very breathed word. It is an absolute miracle, this word. So, being that it is God's word and not man's, we must accept it as God's word. If I have a word for you, do you have to agree with me? No. Ask my wife. She doesn't agree with anything I say. We had an argument yesterday about the name of ramen noodles, how to pronounce it. We had an argument about that, and guess what? She won. I was right, but she still won, because that's just the way it works. Okay? You don't have to agree with everything I say, but the word of God, you do. You do. Why? Because you're a man. You're a little human. You are the creation. He is the creator. We must accept this word as his word, not ours. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, he writes to the Thessalonians. He said, "For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it, not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe." Whenever this word is opened up and preached to us, we need to realize we are hearing from Almighty God. Do you understand that? When if you heard the news this week and you heard George Washington is going to be at Castleberry Baptist this week, you'd probably be a little excited. Okay, one of the last, probably the last good politician we ever had in this country, right? Could have served for his entire life. Wasn't a perfect man, of course. Nobody is. Did some things, but he could have served as president for the rest of his life. He could have been a dictator, right? Because America loved him, right? But you know what? He set a precedent, and he said, no man should be in politics forever. No man should do that. So if he came, just so everybody know who he is. He's on your money. If you don't know who he is, look at the $1 bill. That's about all I got in my wallet. It's $1 bills. But I ain't got no money. My wife has the big bills. Anyway, if you heard that he was going to be here today, and you shut up, and sure enough, he's here, what would you do? You'd probably shut up and listen, right? I mean, it's one of the great world leaders, one of the last good men. You'd probably listen to what he has to say. I mean, it was the president of the United States. Whether you liked him or not, you'd probably listen to what he has to say. But whenever we come here to the house of God and we open up the word, we're not hearing from some world leader. We're not hearing from some man. We don't come here to hear from our pastor or the Sunday school teachers or from me. Sure enough, if you knew I was teaching today, you probably wouldn't have been here. But we don't come here to listen to man. We come here to listen to Almighty God. The one who created all the great world leaders that we've ever had. That one. So we must receive it as God's word, not man's. Because it is God's word, it is absolutely 100% perfect. Every word in it is perfect. You say, I don't agree with this part of the word. Well, just think about this. Yeah, you're wrong. Hey, because your opinion is just opinion. This is God's word. And that's not his opinion. It's truth. God's word is perfect. Psalm 12, verse 6 and 7 says, "The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever." Every word of God, every single bit of it from Genesis to Revelation, it's pure, perfect. Even the stuff that you don't understand, I tell the youth this, believe now and understand later. We ought to strive to understand the word of God every bit, and we ought to never give up to understand the word of God, but you may not understand everything in it. You won't understand everything in it, but you must accept it because it is God's word. You don't have to understand all of his rules, all of his law, but you do have to accept it because it is his word and not man's. You have no choice in the matter. Have no choice. And he preserves it. It's completely pure. God's word is eternal as he is. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away, Jesus said. Every word in this book is eternal. It's just as legitimate 2,000 years ago today as it was 2,000 years ago. It's just as legitimate today, just as true, just as pure. Times change, people change, customs change, but the word of God never changes. It never passes away. Now, if you have any doubt in the validity of Scripture, I wanted to give you this encouragement because we have fulfilled prophecy that testifies to the validity of God's word, 2 Peter tells us. There are over 300 Old Testament prophecies about Jesus that were fulfilled in his life. 300. These prophecies include his virgin birth, his birth in Bethlehem, the healing of the sick, his death on the cross, his bodily resurrection, and many, many more. Dr. Peter Stoner did a study on this and calculated that the odds of one man fulfilling just Just eight of these prophecies is one in 100 quadrillion. Think about that. Think about the size of a silver dollar. 100 quadrillion of those, it would cover the state of Texas 2 feet deep. Think about that. But I believe the word of God because I'm not the source of truth. This is the source of truth in my life. But also it was written over 1,600 years, over 60 generations by more than 40 authors on three different continents, in different circumstances and places, in different times, in three languages. But it all comes together and tells one beautiful story, the story of redemption. This is God's word, not ours. God's word, not ours. It is God's breathed word. It is a miracle. God's word. My second point, God's word is profitable. It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Every scripture in this book is profitable to you. Every single one. The things that you don't like and the things that you do like. The things that make you feel uncomfortable and the things that don't. Every word of it is profitable to you. That's why Paul told the Ephesians, he said, I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. Amen. He wasn't afraid to give them every word of God because every word of God is pure. Every word of God is eternal. So he gave them all the stuff that made them feel uncomfortable. The stuff that poked a finger in their face and said, you have messed up. He wasn't afraid to give that to them. But his word is profitable. And a lot of people, you may think, I don't see how it's profitable to me. I come to church week after week. Sometimes I don't feel any different. Or maybe a preacher, I know preachers struggle with this. Maybe time after time they preach, they do what God has commanded them to do, and they preach this word, they preach it hard, and yet nothing changes sometimes, it seems like. Maybe nobody comes up at the invitation. Nobody seems to have cared what they were listening to, but we know that God's word is profitable no matter what. Isaiah chapter 55, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. His word does what it intends to do. It doesn't always do what we intend it to do, but it does what it intends to do. All scripture given by inspiration of God, breathed by God, and is profitable. It's profitable for four things, it says here, and many more, but four things that are listed here. For doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness. Doctrine, the first word. What is doctrine? Doctrine is instruction. It is teaching what we believe. It is teaching truth, because we know every word in here is truth. John chapter 17, sanctify them by your truth. Thy word is truth. This is our source of truth. This is where we get our instruction to know more about God, know more about how God works, to know truth. If you want to know truth, open up his book. It doesn't depend on your opinions. It doesn't depend on what society does. Truth is from this word of God. When Jesus was asked about divorce by the Pharisees, you know what he went back to? The scripture. He went back to the scriptures. He says, do you not know what the scriptures say? Amen. Your source of truth, you have it. You claim to know it. Look at it. Open it up and look at it. You want to know truth? Open up the word of God. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried. Psalm 18:30 and Psalm 33:4. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. This is the book that teaches us. It instructs us. It gives us the truth. It teaches us truth about God. It teaches us truth about salvation. That is doctrine when we know the truth of God's word. For reproof. Reproof is whenever you tell someone a fault, when you refute the error. Made simple, refute is whenever I say, you have sinned. You have sinned. James chapter 1 gives us the picture of the word of God as a mirror, right? Says, for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a mirror. For he beholdeth himself and goes his way and immediately forgets what manner of man he was. The word of God, when we open it up and we look at it, guess what it does? It reproves us. It shows us that we're guilty sinners. Romans chapter 3, we've been studying on Sunday mornings, the book of Romans. Romans chapter 3, verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be what? Stopped. And all the world may become what? Guilty before God. All this word does, guess what it does? It doesn't show you that you're special. It doesn't, because you're not. What this word does is it shows you you've sinned. You're guilty. It's a mirror. You look into it and you see the filth all over you. You see the filth, and it shuts your mouth. It shows you that you're guilty before God. We often take the Word of God, and we think it's like a lens, right? That's the way some people like to take the Word of God. You'll be sitting there in a sermon, and you'll hear something about some sin, and you'll think, man, that really reminds me of that guy from work. Really does that. That's not the way the Word of God is to be used. Word of God is a mirror. When you look into it, you see yourself. You see the filth, that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that there is none who does good. There is none righteous, no, not one, none that seeketh after God. When we open up the Word of God and see ourselves in the mirror, that's what we see. We see that we're guilty. The Word of God reproves us. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Sometimes it hurts. It hurts sometimes because it pierces us. Right. And we see that we're guilty before God. And we know whenever Jesus was tempted by Satan, he corrected him. He showed him his fault using the Word of God, showed him that he was contrary to Scripture. That is what the Word of God does to us. He used the Word of God to reprove him, right, to show him that you are wrong, you are sinful. Next, it is profitable for correction. Correction comes right after reproof for a reason. It is whenever something is set straight again. When something is taken that was what was off, and it is set straight again. Made set up right again. Made right. And I think we see this in two different ways. First, the setting straight regarding salvation. Now, because of sin, we have fallen off the wagon, right? Headed for hell. But he can pick up a sinner, a dead man, and he can give him life. That is the correction. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 15, just a verse before this passage, it says, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. Isn't that awesome? Though we are sinful, though we are messed up, though we are wicked, though we are condemned, guess what? He can make us right before him through the Word of God. These scriptures can make us wise unto salvation. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. But also, for the Christian who's already saved, this is a picture that it teaches us to repent, to put off sin. 1 Peter chapter 2 says, so put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. James chapter 1 says, therefore put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. The Christian ought not have the garments of wickedness on, because he's been clothed with righteousness. Colossians chapter 3, but now you yourselves are to put off these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds. Put off the old man. As a Christian, we must live a life of repentance. And last, it is profitable for instruction in righteousness. Instruction in righteousness. That is how to walk rightly with God, how to please God, but also chastening or disciplinary correction. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Because of the word, because it has made us wise unto salvation, it changes us. And he saves us unto good works. We're not saved by works. We're not saved by doing good, are we? No, we're saved to good works. We're saved to something, saved for something, so that we can please God. We're saved for the glory of God. And we glory him by living a life that is pleasing to him. Let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. Amen. But also a walk of righteousness as a Christian. Psalm chapter 119, it says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. This word shows us the way that we are to walk. It lights our way so we don't have to walk in darkness. Colossians chapter 3, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This word shows us the way that we are to go. And like I said, we go from that reproof, told that we are sinful, but then we go straight from that to correction. Amen. That we can be made right with God. But then we go straight from the correction also for a Christian of putting off sin, and we are told what to put on. Our instruction in righteousness. We're told to put on love. We're told to put on kindness and humility, meekness, long-suffering. We are told to begin bearing with one another. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Because of this word, we know the way that we are to walk, so we have no excuse. And it's written on our heart as well. We have no excuse. But also, instruction in righteousness does not just talk about how we are to live a life that is pleasing to God, but also it speaks of chastening. So why not both, right? Hebrews chapter 12 speaks of the chastening of God in verses 7 through 11. It says, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastising, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Amen. We endure chastening as Christians. When you sin, you endure chastening. And you know what? It doesn't always feel good. But we can be thankful for it later. And God's word does that to us. Sometimes this word can be like a whooping to you, right? I'm thankful, though, for the chastening that I received as a child. Amen. My mom wasn't any good at it. It didn't hurt. He used to say that to her. Didn't hurt. But man, my dad, he's a big dude, and he's strong, and he was terrifying. But throughout all of it, though it hurt, though it scared me, though I never wanted to go through it, I'm thankful for it today because I know he loves me. I know he loves me. He didn't give me choices in some things. That's a sad thing that parents are saying today. That I know I'm not a parent, right? So I don't have much room to talk, but God's word does. God's word does. It tells us to lead our children, to train them up in the way of the Lord. But I'm thankful that I didn't have choices in things sometimes. That my parents made the choices for me because foolishness was bound up in my heart. So I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that he taught me, that he chastened me. Hallelujah. You say, oh, it doesn't work. Really, you know more than God about raising kids. Really? He's got all us kids. I think he knows more. I think he knows more. So the word to us is profitable for doctrine. It is profitable for reproof. It is profitable for correction and for instruction in righteousness. I wrote a few words to help you understand this, to sum it up and put it all together. God's word is profitable to the unbeliever because it teaches doctrine, the truth of the gospel, the truth of a God who lived a perfect life in human flesh, gave his life for them on the cross, taking the penalty for sin, and rose bodily with new life. It reproves them, teaching them that they are separated and guilty before God by their sin, but it gives them the hope of the gospel message which can correct them and put them in right standing with God, having been justified. And having been justified, they receive instruction in righteousness through the word so that they can live a life that is pleasing to him. But God's word is also profitable to the believer because it reminds us of the one true God, the creator of the universe, who loves us. When we study doctrine, we learn more about how dead in trespasses and sins we were, and rejoice even more at the breadth and length and depth and height of his love toward us. In his reproof, we are reminded once again of what God saved us from, and are humbled by our humanity. In that humbleness, we are led to turn our eyes to him in worship. In correction, we are thankful that God's grace abounds toward us. And in the instruction in righteousness, we take joy in being able to honor a life that is pleasing to him. God's word is profitable to us. Thirdly, God's word must be preached. Because of these first two words, God's word must be preached. All scripture given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction of righteousness. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Now, perfect, that can confuse you a little bit. Many Bibles say complete. complete. And that's what it's speaking of, that we lack nothing, because none of us are perfect, right? But it can make us perfect in the sight of God, amen, which is cool. But also, I think this is talking about how this word completes us and thoroughly furnishes us unto all good works. Without this word, it is impossible to please God. Amen. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Some people think they're living a pleasing life, but never enter the house of God and hear instruction from the word of God. You understand, you may think you can do it on your own, but it is impossible to please God without being under the instruction of this word. Amen. This word is what completes us and furnishes us unto all good works. Without this word, we cannot. But because of that, because Scripture is God-breathed, because it is profitable to us for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. I can't talk. My goodness. Because of that, because it furnishes us unto all good works, God's word must be preached. God's word must be preached. Why? He says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. I charge you in the presence of who? God and the Lord Jesus Christ. In the presence of him. The one that is going to judge you, Timothy. The one who you're going to stand before one day. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're all going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. The one that you're going to stand before. The one who has given you this charge, Timothy. The one who's going to judge both the quick and the dead. I used to have a teacher in sixth grade that said there's two kinds of people in the world, the quick and the dead. I had no idea what it meant. But the living and the dead, who shall judge all. Still don't know what it means. But that one, you're going to stand before him. So, preach the word. The judgment of God is what holds them to their charge. It holds them to their charge. And this is why we must take it seriously when this word of God is preached. It must be taken seriously. This is why we are warned in the scripture that not many of you become teachers. James chapter 3, verse 1. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. This is an important thing. It is a difficult task. And you can be tempted. So you must take it seriously, because you're going to stand before God. So know that your pastor is going to stand before God. He's accountable to God, not you. Amen. Understand that? Amen. His job is not to please you. His job is to please him. Amen. His job is not to tell you what you want. His job is to tell you what he wants. Amen. That is his job. He's going to stand before God. So because of the fact that you're going to stand before him, because of the fact that it is profitable to us, because it furnishes us unto all good works, preach the word. Preach means to herald or to proclaim news, to shout out the good news unashamedly. Preach the word. What do we preach? The what? The word. We don't preach our opinions. We don't preach politics. Saddens me that that's what a lot of churches have turned into. I guarantee you, all around the country, and a lot of churches, a lot of maybe good churches with good pastors who have good intentions, a pastor's up there preaching on how you need to boycott Nike today. Really? Is that worth telling people? Is that worth it? Are people going to die and go into hell over that? Preach the word. Amen. Preach the gospel message. We preach the word because it is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. We preach the word because it assures a truthful message straight from God. Therefore, we can't get mad about it. We can't get mad at the preacher. Galatians chapter 4, Paul says, "Have I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth?" If you've got a problem with it, take it up with God. But we preach the word because it assures a truthful message. It assures doctrine. It assures truth. We preach the word because it gives authority. Amen. Titus 2:15, he says, "These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee." Listen, you don't have to like me. You don't have to care about me. You may think I'm a terrible preacher. That's fine. I'm not that great. Still learning. But you, whenever I'm standing with this word of God, you are under the authority of the word of God. And so a preacher can get in the pulpit with a hammer in hand and hammer it down. Amen. Speak with authority, knowing that he's not going to speak any fallacy whenever he's holding this book. Amen. We preach the word because it is God's chosen method for saving the lost, and it gives glory to God rather than men. I hope whenever you leave church, you don't leave going, man, that pastor over there, he is such a good preacher. I hope you leave church going, man, our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Preaching gives glory to God rather than men. It's God's chosen method. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I've preached over this before. It says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. You understand that? To the world, what you're doing right now is foolish. They think this is the dumbest thing. They think it's dumb that you're sitting here, that you come week after week, Sunday after Sunday, Wednesday after Wednesday, and you listen to someone yell at you for a little bit. They think it's ridiculous. They think it's foolish. But we know that it's powerful. We know it's the power of God to salvation because it's God's chosen method. Where is the scribe? Where is the wise of this world? God's made that foolish. God has shown his power through a foolish message. He's taken that message, made us look like fools. And yet sometimes someone will get up and they'll say, you know what? I need to meet this Jesus. I need to meet that Jesus through a man that doesn't know how to speak, getting up there, speaking, doing his best. The world thinks it's foolish. They even thought it was foolish at a time. Yet God speaks to him through that foolish message. So we can't take the glory for it. God deserves the glory for it. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. God saw that the world thought it was so dumb, so he said, that's the way I'm going to do it. That's the way I'm doing it, right there, because it'll glorify me rather than men. That is why we preach the word rather than politics, rather than opinions. We preach the word. He tells them, says, be instant, in season, out of season. Be instant, be ready, be at hand, like a soldier who's ready to fight, who is prepared, who has on the armor. He must be prepared. In order to be prepared, he must study. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Amen. A pastor must have this book studied before he brings it to the people. He must prepare. That's why we have deacons. Did you know that? That's why it was implemented, so that the preacher could have time to study the word of God. Now, I know a lot of people have bad intentions. A lot of preachers think, well, I don't have to do anything. That's not the way it's supposed to work. But we have that for a reason, so the pastor can study the word of God, so he can be prepared. You know what? I want my pastor to be able to be prepared so I can learn something. I want him to be able to be prepared. He shouldn't have to do everything. And I'm thankful we have good deacons and good people in this church that love to serve the Lord. Be instant, in season and out of season. He's told three things: reprove, rebuke, exhort. Reprove, we already talked about that one. To call out sin. And rebuke is very similar, but they're very different in a little way. One is to call out sin, and one is to bring under the conviction of sin, the best we can understand. We don't know everything about it, but I like what MacArthur said. He says, reproof discloses the sinfulness of sin, whereas rebuke discloses the sinfulness of the sinner. Amen. It doesn't just tell you that what you're doing is a problem, but you are a problem. We are problems. We're wicked. Not good enough to be in God's presence. So he told him, do that stuff. Does that feel good to be told that you're not that great? No, it doesn't feel good. But he told him to do it anyways. He must preach the word without holding back. Exhort. That one's a better of the word. We enjoy that one a little bit more. That is to invite, to entreat, to comfort. John chapter 14, I think some of the most comforting words in all of the Bible. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Amen. Comforting words of the Word of God. The Word of God is comforting to us. And it works that way. Following the rebuke and reproof of sin, we can be comforted. Following that beat down, like we got in the first few chapters of Romans, we can be comforted. but the fact that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So exhort. Don't leave them hanging there with the guilt. And how is he supposed to do that? With all long-suffering and doctrine. He must be patient, and he must do it by teaching the truth, teaching the word of God. The preacher's job is not to guilt you on his own accord. That's not what he can do. His job is to preach the word of God, preach the truth, instruction, that doctrine, the truth of God's word, and let it do its work. Let it do its work. And he must be long-suffering, must be patient. Why must he be patient? Because he's got to put up with all of y'all. Must be patient. I think he's also got to be patient because this is hard work. It is hard work to prepare this, to study this. It is hard work, and it brings you to your knees. So preach the word. God's word must be preached. And lastly, God's word must be received. If God's word is in fact God's word, if this scripture is God-breathed, it is given to us by God himself, not by man, it's not man's word, it's God's word. If it is profitable to us for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness, and if the preacher is charged because he's going to stand before God to preach that word with patience, in season and out of season, when it's popular, when it's not, when it's his time, when it's not, to always be prepared, ready to give a message. If he must do that, then it must be received by us. Because he's told a warning. He's given a warning about the way things are going to change in this world. Verse 3, he says, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. That time has come.
Amen.
It has come. And it is alive and well during this age. The people don't always want to endure the doctrine, because the doctrine, guess what it does? It reproves you. It rebukes you. It tells you you're not good enough, that you must have Jesus Christ's righteousness in your place. It tells you that. So not everybody likes it. So some people turn away from it. They won't endure the sound doctrine. They won't put up with it. If a preacher is going to get up and preach the word, sometimes they think, that's boring. I don't want to sit there and listen to a message through Leviticus. I don't want to hear about that. Doesn't sound fun to me. They won't endure it. They won't put up with it. But instead, after their own lust, because of the wicked desires of our wicked hearts, they'll heap up to themselves teachers having itching ears. And I think there's a point made here between a preacher and a teacher. Let me tell you this, both are 100% necessary, but both are different. But both are necessary, and every preacher must be a teacher, must understand that. But I think the point is here, the preaching involves the rebuke, reprove, and exhort. And I think some people don't want that. Some people don't want that because it steps on your toes. Some people get uncomfortable with that, so they turn away from that, and they just want someone who won't preach to them, but just teach to them. Like I said, every preacher must be able to teach. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach. He must be able to open the word of God and explain it so that you can understand. Filled by the Holy Spirit. He must be able to do that. But we see he's commanded here to reprove, rebuke, exhort. But some people don't like to endure that. So instead, they get someone who won't do any of the reproving and rebuking. But just give them the word. Give them a soft message. Someone that'll tickle their ears because they have itching ears. It's a bad thing to have itching ears. I think of it like a dog. Dogs love nothing more than to have their ears or their belly itched, right? They love it. My dog likes it. If you take your finger and put it right inside the ear, it's so gross, but that dog loves it, and it's weird. Now you all know the weird things I do. Anyways, my dog loves it. Feels so good to get those ears tickled, right? Loves it. Like you like getting your back scratched, right? Just think of it that way. They just want to hear a message that feels good to them. A bunch of fluff. A bunch of lollipops and rainbows. That's all some people want to hear. So they turn away from the truth because the word of God doesn't give us that. But thank God it gives us the gospel. It can make us wise unto salvation. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Many people, because of the word of God, because it's difficult, because it doesn't always make them feel good, they'll turn away from it, and they'd rather just hear a story. And whenever they hear that, there's no truth in it. There's no truth in it. That's why it's a fable. It's fake. It's fiction. It's false. We need to hear truth. We need to hear the truth of God's word. As Hebrews says, as we already read, therefore lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. Amen. Receive that word. Receive it. Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said, therefore whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon the rock. Because of the word, we have a solid foundation. So we must hear the word of God. We must receive it. Amen. Not be like the world that turns away from it. And man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. We absolutely need this word. We need it just as much as we need food to live. We need this word. Like we've already said, we need it to be pleasing to God. You must be under the teaching of the word of God. So I challenge you, as I leave you off, to be like the people of Berea, however you want to pronounce it. In Acts chapter 17, they're described, verses 10 through 12, says, then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Therefore, many of them believed. They got the scriptures, and they heard it, and they searched them out. They received it gladly. They received the word gladly. And I hope you're ready to receive the word of God when you come in here. You don't come here to hear man's message. You come in here to hear the very word of God. So I hope you're ready to receive it. Because God Almighty, the creator of the universe, takes time to speak to us. So I hope you're ready to receive it. And like the Bereans, I pray that you'll search them out. I hope this church time is not the only time you open that word of God. I hope that daily you are in the word of God. Make a commitment to do that. Have accountability with someone. My wife and I, during the new year, we decided that we were both going to hold each other accountable to that. To read the word of God every day. To take time to do that. And we hold each other accountable. We make sure we both read every day. So we usually read together. So read with somebody. But search the scriptures. You know what? It says they searched the scripture to find out whether those things were true. Think about that. I would love nothing more if I preach the word of God and I preach it with a hammer in my hand with authority. And you come to me and you say, you know what? I'm not sure about that. I need to study it more. Praise the Lord for that. Praise the Lord for that. Don't take it just from me. It must be from the word of God. Take it from the word of God and then you can know its truth. So receive the word of God like the Bereans. That's my challenge for you today. Let's pray.